This is Musings of the Shy Podcast. I'm your host, Roja Shy.
This is Roja Shy here with another episode on our series about the aftermath of Silk Road, the collapse of the marketplace. First episode of this series discussed the corrupt agents, Sean Bridges and Karl Marx Force IV on Agents of Silk Road. And now we're talking about the marketplace in itself and how people are taking the concept of Silk Road, creating a marketplace for everything, regardless of what that type of product may be, and decentralizing it so that no one entity can control the marketplace, but also no other entities can come in and try to track vendors, customers, whether it be for ad placement purposes or for prosecuting people for crimes, for example, because they're selling weed or some kind of narcotic, or the locale that they're in, the particular trade that they're in is not necessarily legal. You know, there's still places in parts of the, not only in the States, but in the world where you can't distribute alcohol or something like that. Something that's kind of benign, but can be still considered a serious crime in some places. So this is episode 14 about the decentralized marketplace. But before we get into the nature of not only what decentralization is, we're going to talk about the news. So the RIAA wants ISPs to automatically filter pirate content. This comes from the DSL reports. It was written by Carl Brody. The IRA, which is the radio, it's like the record company's trade company, their public arm, if you will, that goes after anyone and everyone and protects their trade industry. The IRA continues to insist the DMCA, considered one of the most draconian copyright laws ever crafted, doesn't go far enough. And ISP should be forced to filter out pirate content. The push comes in a letter sent by the IRA and 14 other groups to the U.S. Copyright Office. In the letter, the IRA claims that the safe harbor protections granted by the DCMA to ISPs that move to expeditiously remove copyright infringed material doesn't go far enough, and more heavy-handed actions by ISPs are necessary. This is just kind of ridiculous, personally. First off, the system that currently works is not working at all. Really, it doesn't acknowledge fair usage. You have companies that don't really exist going against other channels or other places and saying that you're using their copyrighted material when, in fact, they're not even the actual copyright holder. So it's all of it is just a big old mess. And they just, honestly, they may need to repeal the DMCA, either start from scratch or make some serious amendments to the act in and of itself. The screaming burdensome and ultimately inefficient notice and takedown process is hardly a fair exchange for the highly valuable immunity that the DMCA safe harbors give service providers, allowing them to continue profitable businesses operating while avoiding liability for copyright infringement and the potential for statutory damages, states the letter. For one thing, the RIA wants the term expeditionally remove and replace with a harder time frame in which ISPs are forced to take action. But the RIA then continues to insist that having ISPs automatically remove copyrighted material almost immediately would be a nifty idea. One possible solution to the problem would be to require that once a service provider receives a takedown notice with respect to a given work, the service provider uses automatic content identification technology to prevent the same work from being uploaded in the future, states the letter. That's technologically not possible. Another option would be to require the use of such technology to identify and take action with respect to known third-party copyrighted works at the time of uploading and sharing. That might somewhat be feasible, but again, it's just not going to happen. People are just going to create other sites and other locations and be in countries or servers out of the reach of the U.S. Copyright Office and the ISPs themselves. The problem, of course, is the automated content identification technology consists already resulted in legitimate content, including fair use, being removed from the internet. Expanding to this include automated removal technology at the ISP level, and you're likely looking at an exponential explosion in the removal of non-infringed content. The RIA's letter comes as the House Judiciary Committee prepares to take a new look at the nation's copyright laws. SpaceX is sending privately crewed Dragon spacecraft beyond the moon next year. We'll have some other SpaceX news, news concerning their rocket relaunch, but this is concerning the privatization of space and the effort to travel to the moon, if you will, and potentially Mars. We are excited to announce that SpaceX has been approached to fly two private citizens on a trip around the moon late next year. They've already paid a significant deposit to do a moon mission. Like the Apollo astronauts before them, these individuals will travel in space carrying the hopes and dreams of all humankind, driven by the universal human spirit of exploration. We expect to conduct health and fitness tests as well as beginning initial training later this year. Other flight teams have also expressed strong interest, and we expect more to follow. Additional information will be released about the flight teams, contingent upon their approval and confirmation of the health and fitness test results. So they plan on going to the moon, which is a very extremely ambitious project. We do have the technology to do it on a private level. It's just a matter of seeing whether or not SpaceX is going to be successful in doing something that the government did almost 50 years ago, 1968, is that when we were, whenever we landed on the moon in the 60s, 1964, somewhere around there when we landed on the moon. No, it was 69 is when we landed on the moon. It would be interesting to see what the results are going to be and what they're going to achieve. They're going to be successful, you know, not only breaking over it, but going around and going towards the moon. I have some ups and downs when it comes to the privatization of space. We'll eventually do, on the metaverse, we'll do about space and robotics and the privatization of a lot of different areas and whether or not it's beneficial for mankind, beneficial for science, and whether or not we're actually progressing forward in our achievements of, you know, just further knowledge. In our knowledge base, if you will. How to self-publish a novel in 2017. The reason why I include this is by Zach Hubert is because decentralized marketplaces with places like Yours, which is supposed to be unwrapping at some point this year, and other similar marketplaces where you're able to publish written content, you know, audio content, entertainment, if you will, in a decentralized manner that is outside the purview of a lot of the already existing business infrastructures. Already, the book industry has been hammered by the internet, thanks to Amazon. That particular book selling place has expanded to selling everything and anything. You've seen the collapse of big book places. Publishing companies have changed the nature of the way they publish. You have the self-publishing platform within Amazon and a few other big sites. So that has increased a number of big selling authors have gone to self-publishing, but also a lot of authors have become published through self-publishing where they take the time and do, get an editor to edit their book, make it formatted for ebook and Kindle, as well as, you know, the hard and paperback versions and sell it directly to their consumers and market that way. A lot of those books, some of them were, you might say, financial guru books or self-help books were kind of the biggest sellers that were doing this. And then eventually you had a lot of fiction books going out there, all sorts of different fiction. Romance is a big one, self-publishing. A lot of fanfic is out there being self-published in book format, actually, not just on blogs or Tumblrs, if you will. So it's a very big emerging market, if you will, and I just included it here as far as the show notes go, and just going to read a little bit about it, just to kind of intro this. It's by Zach Hubert, How to Self-Publish a Novel in 2017. While putting the finishing touches on Singular, I thought it would be nice to capture all the things required to self-publish a novel, so that any reader thinking of doing likewise, or myself in a year or two, as a ready guide for the process. I'm not an expert at this, but I hope this is valuable nonetheless. As this is going to be rather long, let's break this up in sections. Writing, what should I use while I'm writing? Get help, who will I need to help me? Prepare to publish, how to prepare my manuscript for publication? And publish, how do I get my book into various ebook paperback channels? Though I should point out, if you're looking for a TLDR, perhaps writing novels isn't an ideal pastime. So there's different stuff he outlines, from Skinnyver, which combines research, outline pictures, program to help you write the novel you're writing, prepare font manner of the actually publishing, like the font of a particular book, and even associated with genres is very, very important. There's a lot of stuff that goes into the whole book process, if you will. So I just found it very fascinating. It's a, like I said, it, like the author himself said, it's a very long read, but interesting nonetheless. So some cryptocurrency news. Japan declares sale of Bitcoin exempt from consumption tax. The Japan's consumption tax, this comes from Bitcoin.com. It was written by Kevin Helms. The consumption tax is a tax levied on spending on goods and services by the consumption tax law, a municipal law in Japan. The system can be considered as similar to the VAT, or value added tax, or GSTS, goods and service tax, or sales tax, described by the Kyoto City Official Travel Guide website. The Yacht of Japan explained that before the tax bills were passed, digital currencies such as Bitcoin do not fall under the category of exempt sales. As a result, the sale of virtual currencies in Japan have been treated as a taxable for GCT, Japanese consumption tax purposes. In Japan, the consumption tax is currently a flat 8% of all on all items, but is scheduled to increase to 10% in October of 2019. On March 27th, the Japanese National Diet passed the 2017 tax reform bills, which include amendments to the fund settlement law enacted last May. The proposed amendments were agreed on by the Japan's ruling coalition last December. The fund settlement law newly defined virtual currencies as means of settlement, according to the Dole Japan, which explains the sale of virtual currencies defined under the new funded settlement law be exempt from GCT. The change will apply to sale purchase transactions performed in Japan on or after July 1st of 2017. But there are still other taxes. The new rule defines digital currencies as asset-like values that can be used in making payments and can be transferred digitally, reported Japan's Times. Therefore, Bitcoin and other digital currencies are no longer liable for consumption tax of 8%. However, being an asset-like digital currency, trading is still liable for capital gains tax, which is something similar to that of the law here in the United States. Profits from trading Bitcoin, when coming from continuous trading for the purpose of generating profit, can be considered as an income for business activities or miscellaneous income, explains Japan's largest exchange by volume, Bitflyer. However, in the case of the sale of Bitcoin held for investment purposes, it can be considered a capital gain. And then BTCManager.com, which was written by Jamie Holmes, again, kind of talking about the news, but it gives it a little bit more better, I think, the clarity of what the law is stating. Bitcoin rebounds on legal tender status in Japan, BTC Manager Week Review of April 3rd. The price of Bitcoin is gaining strength, with the price trading around 11.50 at the time of writing, following attainment of legal tender for cryptocurrencies Japan effective April 1st. In the altcoin world, Litecoin and Ripple, two established incumbents, have flexed their muscles and displaced a significant increase in both volume and price. In a major step forward for Bitcoin adoption, the world's fourth largest economy has granted the cryptocurrency legal status as a method of payment. As highlighted by BTC Manager, Japan also operates a whitelist of approved cryptocurrencies, likely to remain conservative and roll around established altcoins such as Ether. However, in the wake of the news out of Japan, EXM, a popular altcoin in the country, has surged in value even against Bitcoin. Litecoin and Ripple have both displaced an increase in value in excess of 100% at one point last week. Accompanying the huge influx of volume, Litecoin's price most likely jumped due to the combination of factors favorable to the altcoin. Progress on SegWit and the introduction of margin trading at GDAX, as well as potential cooperation with Tether. So it kind of goes over the history here of Japan officially recognizing Bitcoin as legal tender, which we covered in the last article. But it's very important, I think, as there's significant clarity, if you will, for cryptocurrencies. I just wish they would just acknowledge and come out and say that it's actual tender. It just makes things much easier instead of these little increments, if you will. But we are where we are currently as we speak. Some Dogecoin news here. Dodecatherm, the agglomeration of the two popular altcoins. Jason Tesche and Christian Ritbinser has published their work detailing a protocol of how Dogecoin will be received into the Ether network, known as TrueBit, in their white paper, a scalable verification solution for blockchains. The March 28th Reddit post calls for help on the Dogecoin side so the Doge doesn't get locked up in Ethereum. In a nutshell, the TrueBit is basically an Ethereum smart contract with a sole purpose in Dothethereum and Solana Ethereum to check Dogecoin script proof of work, which is something that the current Ethereum smart contracts cannot do. So there's some progress on that. Oh, and in some news, because of the Hawaiian law concerning cryptocurrency, Coinbase has just stopped serving customers in Hawaii. And then finally, Dogecoin backs up its bark with Byte. This is from the Merkle, and it's written by Darcius. Hope I said that right. The recent couple of weeks has been extremely interesting when looking at the various altcoins and how they are faring against Bitcoin and fiat currency. Recently, ETF rejections, along with increasingly uncertain fiat markets and the drama between Bitcoin Core and Bitcoin Unlimited, which we won't be talking about for a while now, a continuing and needless nasty debate over block size limits, have paved the way for these altcoins to have a bit of a pump. While it may seem obvious that it may be a pump and dump, we're all too used to seeing, I wonder if it's not a bit more concrete, as most of these coins have enjoyed a rise than a stable price for longer than most pump and dumps will allow. One of these coins is very dear to me, Dogecoin. Its performance recently has shown that the pump still has some teeth. A moonshot may not be seen so outlandish anymore. Dogecoin prides itself on being fun and friendly cryptocurrency, and they're willing to put their money where their snout is. The coin itself is insanely approachable, as most transactions would only use integers, not fractions of coins. It's hard not to have a smile on your face when you pay for some hot sauce with Doge, or even when you're buying an airline ticket with it. In addition to this, the community largely associated on Reddit, our Dogecoin, is one of the kindest groups of individuals you can come across. Training knowledge and tipping coins, these shies make sure that everyone feels welcome and that no one is afraid to speak up and talk about the coin. They also still rather active in philanthropic endeavors, as evidenced by the ongoing Socks for Homeless. More than anything else, the reasons are why I'm so excited for this coin's recent performance. Some of the more dramatic increases may very well be due to a pump and dump, but this time I think that its base level has moved up as well. What I mean to say is that when the dump does happen, I think the coin will be better in a better position than immediately prior to its pump. All this is good for any altcoin, but I think Dogecoin is a bit of an edge on other coins that may find themselves in a similar situation. That is because Dogecoin has been historically incredibly stable against fiat currency. The stability sets it apart from a lot of other coins. It's also an increasingly fast confirming currency, where the transaction fee is next to nothing. For speed and cost, Dogecoin seems to outpace almost any other competitor. Moreover, Dogecoin may have one of the more potent safeguards for its survival, is the community. The community that surrounds Dogecoin does care about the price of the coin and the value of the investment reserve, but seems to be far more concerned with maintaining this community and proliferating the knowledge about the coin. For a cryptocurrency with such a playful, bark, and fun nature, it still has the bite to back it and prove that it's relevant still. Dogecoin demonstrates Mark Twain's old adage, it's not about the size of the dog in the fight, it's the size of the fight in the dog. A quick reminder is that my opinion and non-investment advice, the best advice you can give is never invest anything more than you can lose. And that is it for the news.
So let's discuss where we're at. With the collapse of the Silk Road marketplace, other drug marketplaces try to come up onto the market through Tor and using Bitcoin as the primary currency of trade. But many of them started getting shut down. Some of them have, in fact, what is known as exit scams. And we'll discuss that later in the episode, what exactly is the nature of an exit scam. But it wasn't quite working. They didn't have the same ideology that Ross Ulrich and the various moderators or alleged moderators had about running Silk Road. And so as a way to address the issue of commerce, e-commerce in particular, when it comes to be something that is scissor-resistant, lacks government interference, doesn't have a conglomerate, if you will, or a corporation running the particular marketplace like your Amazons, your Google Play, your eBay, if you will. Something that was peer-to-peer, decentralized, would be the solution to addressing the selling of goods and wares across borders, across commerce, with the usage of Bitcoin as the currency of trade. And so a number of individuals sought to provide that solution, and we'll talk about those companies. But before we get into that, we need to talk about just exactly the state that we are in. Because it's not just about the dark web when it comes to selling you drugs or whatever, which was the primary trade on Silk Road. It's just about commerce in general and trade in general that's going on in the global world, and the internet, and how it's a nexus for both good and bad things. So this article is by Anil Dash, and he talks about tech and the fake market tactic. It's out of Human Tech off of Medium. So, tech and the fake market tactic. In one generation, the internet went from opening up new free markets to creating a series of fake markets that exploit society without most media or politicians even noticing. The open internet markets. American culture loves to use the ideal of competitive free markets as a solution to all kinds of social problems. Though the vaunted free market has no incentive to, say, take care of babies with cancer, a well-functioning market can definitely be a great way to see which provider offers the cheapest price for a roll of toilet paper or a bushel of apples. Given the cultural predilection of some of the first things people made in the early days of the web were new markets, perhaps a canonical example was eBay. Almost anybody, could list their ceramic figurines for sale on eBay and participate in a relatively fair market. On one side, a gaggle of figurine aficionados enthusiastically search for the best deals. On the other, a bunch of figurine vendors competing on price, quality, and service. In the middle, a neutral market that just helps connect buyers and sellers through instantly updated information. Everybody's happy. Later, a seller could buy a preferred position for the products in eBay search results, and some product categories started to be dominated by wholesale suppliers, but still remain a relatively open system. Everybody mostly happy. Not long after eBay started, Google launched it as a sort of a market of content, with its page ranking system choosing which pages showed up in our search results, ranked by the number of inbound links. On one side were readers, on the other side we had publishers, and in between was Google, using a mysterious but still kind of comprehensible algorithm to create a market where almost everybody felt like they could participate. But before long, those rankings started to be tainted by spammers, due to the fact that higher ranking in those listings suddenly had a monetary value, and making spam links was cheaper than paying for Google's advertising product. What was an open market to do? 2. The rise of the rigged markets. The inevitable automated game of the early open digital markets inevitably catalyzed the start of the next era. Rigged markets. Google got concerned about nefarious search engine optimization tricks and kept changing their algorithm, meaning that pretty soon the only web publishers that could thrive were those who could afford to keep tweaking their technology to keep up in this new arms race. After just a few years, this became a rich get richer economy and incentivized every smaller publicizer to standardize on one set of few publishing tools in order to keep up with Google's demands. Only the biggest content providers could afford to build their own tools while simultaneously following the demands of Google's ever-changing algorithm. The problem eventually became more pronounced in the most valuable markets. Eventually, its lucrative vertical markets like travel, Google started showing its own flight booking tools ahead of third-party results from traveling book sites, based on the idea that their experience was better for consumers than the confusing and inconsistent results from third parties. This was true, but it was also pretty damn convenient for Google, which now started to make more money on those links. This was the start of the subtle but critical important pattern on the web. A short-term improvement in user experience helped a single dominant tech company take over a legacy market in the long term. Amazon went through a similar process when it started putting its thumb on the scale, showing its own products first when doing a product search, even if they weren't the cheapest. We saw a rapid shift where the companies hosted formerly open markets started to give themselves unfair advantages that couldn't be countered by other sellers in the market. This shift to rigged markets was perfected in the app stores, where the major players like Apple and Google choose which apps get featured and promoted and prevented the creation of any app that would displace or threaten their market dominance. Even if an app does succeed, the App Store promotes an ad-supported model that makes app creators dependent on the tech company's platform for distribution, instead of an app deriving revenues directly from its users. But even today's rigged markets have some ways the new players can compete. You can release a new photo sharing app and theoretically try to compete with Instagram or Snapchat on Apple's App Store. An ordinary shopper could search for beach, bed sheets on Amazon's website and expect to get a list of linens to purchase, both from independent manufacturers and from Amazon's own Paizon brand. Even if these markets are skewed, they're still markets and they leave some opportunity. That's not to say these systems are fair. The big companies can pick which players in the market get to compete, and issues of network inequality mean people or companies that are privileged enough to be early adopters get unfair advantage. But even in these inequities, we could muddle through and new products or competitors could sometimes emerge. This has been the status quo for almost the last decade. The next rising wave of tech inventors twists the definition of market even further to a point where they aren't actually markets at all. Now the fake markets. Uber's promise is simple. You can use your app to hail a cab, and one driver from a pool of independent drivers agrees to pick you up. And everybody's happy. In their formation, their neutral marketplace connecting customers and service providers, kind of like eBay. But unlike competitive sellers on eBay, Uber drivers can't set their prices. In fact, prices can be and regularly have been changed unilaterally by Uber. And passengers can make informed choices about selecting a driver. The algorithm by which a passenger driver are matched is opaque to both the passenger and the driver. In fact, as Data Society research has shown, Uber has deliberately misrepresented the market available cars by showing ghost cars to users in the Uber app. It seems the market has some awful weird traits. Consumers can't trust the information they're being provided to make a purchase decision. A single opaque algorithm defines which buyers are matched with which sellers. The sellers have no control over their own pricing or profit margins. Regulators are the genuine short-term consumer benefit, but doesn't realize the long-term harms that can arise. This, by a reasonable definition, no market at all. One might even call Uber a fake market. Yet by carefully describing drivers in the system as entrepreneurs and appropriating the language of true marketers, Uber has been welcomed by communities and policymakers as they are creating a new marketplace. This has serious implications for policy, regulation, and even civil rights. For example, we sincerely laud Uber for making it easier for African-American passengers to readily hail a car when they need a ride, but if the persistent pattern of the bias from drivers arises again at Uber era, we have a harder time regulating those abuses because Uber doesn't usually follow the same policies as licensed taxis. The pseudo-market patterns also mask patterns of subsidies, like the fact that Uber's current operations are subsidized by investors to the tune of $2 billion a year. That a cost that will immediately pass along to consumers as soon as Uber succeeds in displacing conventional taxis. The Financial Times states the implications of the economic range are very clear. All this equates to is an economic transfer from the working class over to the urban metropolitan elites, which benefits one particular corporation over others. This is plain crazy. These new false markets only resemble true markets just enough to pull the wool over eyes of regulators and medias, whose enthusiasm for high-tech solutions is boundless and whose understanding of markets on the internet is still stuck on the early era of eBay 20 years ago. Fake markets just don't happen in traditional products and services. They're coming to the world of content and publishing too. Publishers are increasingly being incentivized to use platforms like Facebook's Instant Articles and Google's AMP format. Like Uber's temporarily subsidized cheaper prices and broader access to ride-hailing, these new publishing formats do offer some short-term consumer benefits in the form of faster loading times and cleaner reading experiences. But the technical mechanics by which Facebook and Google provide that faster reading experience happens to incidentally displace most of the third-party advertising platforms, the ones that aren't provided by Facebook and Google themselves. Facebook publishers who use these new distributing channels are incentivized to use Facebook advertising platforms, where payment rates and profit margins can unilaterally be changed at any time. Just as Uber subsidized fares during the phase when they're displacing regulated taxis, Facebook subsidized publishers' ad rates during the phase when they're displacing third-party advertising networks. And then the article kind of goes on. And so this is just kind of the state of the marketplace, of the tech marketplace, and about how it's being rigged by these different companies, the app markets, and just how it's just entrenched everywhere, this ideology, if you will. And then you have the concept of decentralization, seeking to not have a centralized authority like a Facebook or an Uber or eBay or any of these places having a direct control, which was the problem of Silk Road, the marketplace. Because everything went through their servers, all the transactions and actions of, you know, buying and selling, there was a record, if you will, located in a server. And also Silk Road took a fee. They took a cut, if you will, of every transaction that occurred. And if they gone on longer, maybe they would raise the fees or cut the fees or favor different products or something like that. We'll never know because the marketplace had shut down. But because of the nature of the marketplace, much like Napster, the reason why Napster failed, even though it was a peer-to-peer type of action, that's what Silk Road was peer-to-peer, connecting people, one group to another, they still had a centralized server system. And so the solution was, hey, why don't we create a decentralized system where it's just software, where nobody controls directly anything. For example, you would just download the program or an app. And in the app are the different features that you need, like loading the picture for your product, naming your product, the categories, and then setting the price, and then accepting the price. And then a customer will download the same type of app and come in as a customer and looks for, say, roller skates, and just enters roller skates and seeks out all the different types of vendors that sell roller skates, and can see the vendors as they are rated, because that's a thing that's been done through Amazon, eBay, and all the different places, and, you know, the like button, rating and validating, you know, hey, this is a good vendor, I purchased it, or this is a bad vendor, or I had this bad experience, and going through the different types of vendors to purchase their roller skates. And they might have criteria, they might have, you know, high rating, good prices, or maybe they're looking for a very specific set, like only black roller skates with red wheels, and looking for that, and speaking directly to the vendor to get their black roller skates, maybe even negotiating the set price, purchasing, finding out the shipping, both international or just domestic, and going through all that themselves and using the software. And there's no cut by eBay. There's no preferential promotional payment to get listed higher than anybody else. Nobody's controlling anything. Your information is maintained on the mobile app or your desktop device. Is not on any particular server, and as soon as you disconnect or even delete that information is gone. The transaction history is no longer associated with that person. No one could track it down, if you will, in such an easy manner. Now, maybe if they hit the vendor, maybe the vendor will have, depending on how they kept their records, maybe the vendor has all the sales transactions in their history. And that is something that I think a lot of, when it comes to the dark web for drug transactions, for illicit transaction, that is a thing that needs to be worked upon, like disappearing messages on both ends, where you can somehow ensure or secure or minimize the impact of one person is caught over the other. If the consumer is caught or is an informant, the vendor is caught and has a list of all the addresses, maybe that information gets disappeared within the system. In some type of fashion. This, of course, doesn't prevent anyone from, print screening everything and keeping records that way, or video screen capturing all their information and securing it in that fashion. That can't be stopped rolling. But internally within the software program, maybe minimizing that type of an impact or that type of a locale, if you will, or that type of information being contained is not maintained. And there's all sorts of different things that people are looking at about encrypted messages, about how to decentralize, how to make it, you know, peer-to-peer, how to not have centralized servers, what if I can't run the full operating system on my computer, how can I connect, making those connections to the mobile devices. And so there's, because of the way Silk Road was taken out, because of that server was sought, and it's very suspicious how it was found, it's very suspicious on how all the information was taken. The fact that there's constantly new information coming out about Silk Road, that there's another copy of information that's not matching the law enforcement information. All these type of things is allowed for people to say, hey, maybe we can do it this way to prevent government interference. And then another solution is because of exit scams. And we're going to talk about exit scams that happened because in the wake of the Silk Road marketplace. Because of there's such increased law enforcement heat, and law enforcement was infiltrating all these different drug marketplaces, posing as buyers, pretending to be vendors, trying to actively hack and seek out all these dark marketplaces or information to using a method called de-anonymizing them, a method they purchased through the Cambridge University, this paper that was published and a method that many people believe that they use and has been publicized to de-anonymize Tor traffic and to find the servers of these different marketplaces, to find the vendors, to find out people, you've had this increase that's known as an exit scam. So an exit scam is actually a very old confidence trick that's been around in scamming since scamming's been scammed. Scammers have been scamming. But when applicable to Tor and the dark web and these emerging dark marketplaces that were inspired by Silk Road, I mean, it was because of Silk Road that a lot of these dark market sites came into existence. While there was selling and trading of drugs through Tor and online in general for a very long time, I mean, if you go through old Craigslist adverts, you could find that information. Backpage has been known to do that through the clear web, if you will. But Silk Road just basically perfected the online transactions of vendor to user and with Bitcoin as payment and having a very user-friendly, clean website, well-run, well-maintained, very professional-looking, basically eBaying/Amazoning the drug market, if you will. It was very extremely successful and profitable type of a venture for everyone involved. Vendor, user, even the people that ran the drug marketplace. But as a result of the shutdown of Silk Road, not everyone had the same type of ideology, belief that Ross Ulbricht and the number of people that gravitated and became the moderators and admins of Silk Road. As a result of that, we've had the existence of exit scams. So an exit scam is a confidence trick where an established, usually illegal business, i.e. a seller of drugs, stops shipping orders while continuing to receive payments for new orders. If the entity had a good reputation, then it takes some time before it's widely recognized that the orders are not shipping, and the entity can then make off with the money paid for the unshipped orders. Exit scams can be tempting alternatives to a non-fraudulent shutdown for illegal operations. If the operation was going to shut down anyway for other reasons, if an illegal entity lives by, e.g. selling drugs, it's not an unusual option for the cheated buyers to call the police. The example mentioned in news articles online sellers where the buyer does not know the identity or physical location of the scammer and therefore has little recourse. The online black market evolution is cited as the biggest exit scam as of 2016. Here, the administrators apparently made off with 12 million in Bitcoin, which was held in escrow on the marketplace. Individual vendors often reach at a point of reputation maturity where they have sold a sufficient project to accumulate both significant reputation and escrow funds that they may choose to exit with those funds rather than compete at the high volume, high price matured product level. Evolution was one of the biggest ones. It wasn't the only one. There was a series of just a rapid one after another of these dark marketplaces that were shutting down and making off with their consumers, both the vendor and the buyer's funds. It was just a repeated action over and over and over again. And as a response to that, a lot of people have started investing into not only into decentralized marketplaces, but a way to prevent such transactions from happening, where the escrow is not held by the creator of the software program or some centralized entity. It's done through either software actions or through a third-party vendor or not at all. This way it will safeguard some of these actions where unscrupulous people will just set up a tent, become very efficient at being very good at establishing a drug marketplace, making it, you know, the UI good, gathering vendors, gathering consumers, and going to having trade going on, and then as the escrow holder, walking away with people's funds after a certain amount. And because of that, there has been a significant decline in the drug marketplace. But also more importantly, like I said, some people saw this as a solution to what is happening. To protect customers, to protect to do commerce in a different way, to allow for a censorship-free trading of goods across borders with cryptocurrency as the primary payment form, to be able to conduct business that way online. And it doesn't necessarily have to be through Tor. It can actually occur on the ClearNet, and we'll talk about a couple of those type of businesses. But these efforts were just a direct response because of the collapse of Silk Road.
So before we go into the terms of what a decentralized place is and peer-to-peer, we're going to talk a little bit about evolution, just the way of the marketplace and what was going on here, and kind of what it means, the impact of it means to this type of marketplace. I have a PDF of a recent paper that was published by Nick Jantonis and Janet Till called Reputation Dynamics in a Marketplace for Illicit Drugs. I'm just going to read the abstract here. This came out of the University of Pennsylvania and is a work in progress. We analyzed reputation dynamics in an online market for illicit drugs using a novel database of price and ratings. The market is a black market, and so contracts cannot be enforced. We study the role a reputation plays in alleviating adverse selection in this market. We document the following stylized facts. One, there's a positive relationship between the price and the rating of a seller. This, in fact, is increasing the number of reviews left for the seller. A mature, highly rated seller charges a 20% higher price than the mature, low-rated seller. Two, sellers with more reviews charge higher prices regardless of rating. And three, low-level sellers are more likely to exit the market and make fewer sales. We show that these stylized facts are explained by a dynamic model of adverse selection, ratings, and exits, in which buyers form rational inference about the quality of a seller jointly from his ratings and number of sales. Sellers who receive a low rating and initial charge the same price as highly rated sellers since early reviews are less informative about quality. Bad sellers exit rather than face lower prices in the future. We provide conditions under which our model emits a unique equilibrium. We estimate the model and use the result to compute returns to reputation in the market. So again, another factor for decentralizing these marketplaces was about reputation. Reputation seemed to be very solid within the drug marketplace, and just in general, just in markets in general. That's why you have places like Yelp, the stars and likes on Facebook, and reviews of that nature. But as we talked about the fake market and the closing the marketplace, what has happened was, and this is what got Yelp in trouble, is they would shake down small businesses to highlight or hide their negative reviews and highlight their good reviews, or have them on board with Yelp to get preferential treatment for reviews, which could have a very adverse effect on a business if Yelp all of a sudden just floods their place with negative reviews, or there's not a strong control for trolling, if you will, or false reviews where someone has never actually ate at a place or something like that. It really is harmful to an individual's reputation. Same thing with Amazon. There was now Amazon has curtailed the ability for people to do reviews for sellers, where they're limited to 10. Again, it was just this is the new Google linkage, where companies, either through directly or through a third party, were paying people to review their product, whether it be sending the product out directly to an individual, or paying them per word or per review for them just to talk about a product and to increase their ratings, you know, 3, 4, 5-star rating, and having some kind of blurb of a review for people to read. And it was really messing with the Amazon metrics. Particularly when you can look at certain products and then just jump down to the reviews, and just by the nature of the reviews and the verbiage being utilized, you could tell that it was fake. And so you couldn't gauge as a consumer with any kind of good reason or inference whether or not a product was good or not. And so with a place like this where you don't have any buying into, if you will, or you don't have any page rankings when it comes to a decentralized marketplace, where you literally would have to have purchased a good store to make some type of ranking on a vendor. Again, this is a type of solution that would kind of help and curtail, where being good at what you're doing is something that can be measured and has some kind of merit, and that therefore you can be rewarded for putting out a good product, or having a good delivery time, or being flexible when it comes to maybe something doesn't get through, or there's an issue with payment or something like that. Having a strong reputation gets you rewarded, if you will. And the reason why I say you can kind of verify with a decentralized marketplace where you have to purchase the goods is you can, because of some of
the things that some of the software programs are doing is where you have to use like encrypted messages and sign keys. And because of blockchain technology, you can track and go through the transaction histories and say, hey, we'll prove your transaction history because this is my, everyone knows this is where you, the payment protocol, my payment. So if you made the payment, where's the proof? The proof in the pudding. How can you use your SCGO as a user, say that you purchase a product and give me one rating when there's no transaction history whatsoever? So with that, there's, you know, because of blockchain technology, you can verify something. Same thing is, for example, user CSGO was purchasing from, you know, vendor Keemoon. And he's saying he didn't get his product, nothing was delivered, he sent the funds. He can prove that there was a transaction history of being sent and that he has some kind of history with He-Man. The whole proving the product not being delivered can be questionable because, again, it's a physical commodity. What are you doing? You're tracking products through the mailing poster system. Maybe if it's illegal, you can do that. If it's unlisted, you know, using drop addresses and stuff like that, or as far as, you know, the list it goes, it might be a little bit more tricky. But at least you can verify for user SCGO says, I sent monies to He-Man and I wasn't made whole. And so that's why I can put it a 1-star. And you can believe my word or not. Maybe you can go through a user SCGO's user history and see if he 1-stars a bunch of vendors, or if he's pretty reasonable, or even leaves reviews. You know, you can judge his reputation that way when it versus He-Man's reputation by stating, you know, I do deliver my products on time and look at all my ratings for users. There's that kind of check and balance for both ends as far as both the user and the vendor. Not that you can't do this in the open marketplace, and I just want to touch on it briefly with credit card histories, and because the open marketplace, if you will, you know, you have, you know, UPS and Postal Service and FedEx and all those type of delivery services, you can track all that down. You can still do it that way, but with this way, it's not as easy, I think, to game the system as much as you could with a clear marketplace type of deal. With credit card chargebacks, and even if a product is delivered and the vendor can verify through tracking history that a product was delivered, the individual can still say they didn't receive the product because they can say, well, I didn't sign for it, or the product must have been taken off by a thing, or it didn't happen. They can still say that and so not pay for the goods. You know, that's the problem with credit cards. It's so heavily preferential to the user. Even if a vendor can prove and document through all the different technology, whether it be videotape, email transactions, you know, tracking history that a service was rendered, they're still not going to get, you know, their settlement if you're wrong. And that just sucks, really. So let's get into talking about evolution here. So evolution was one of the bigger drug marketplaces through the Tor. It was also Argo, which also had an issue, and a few others, but evolution was one of the bigger ones. And when it went down, I think it was kind of like the death blow to the drug marketplace, because while there's still activity, it is not to the level it once was when Silk Road was ongoing, but more importantly, just after Silk Road's collapse, there was a huge rush of all sorts of different drug marketplaces trying to fill that void that Silk Road had left in the marketplace. Even the creation of a second Silk Road happened, and that person was taken down. A couple of different marketplaces were taken down by law enforcement, but things, you know, they still continue. People want to buy drugs. People want to sell drugs. It's going to happen. You know, black markets exist, and they've always existed. So basically what happened was a member of the Evolution Marketplace went on to Reddit, into the Darknet market forum there, and said, hey, guys, this is what's going on. Evolution is a scam, and they're going to take your funds. So this article comes from Deep Dive Web, written by
or at least it's posted by D.Web, it doesn't state who writes it. Evolution Market staff member, 130,000 BTC were stolen. That's a lot. Today, D.Web conducted a short interview with NSW Great, the now former Evolution Market staff member, who was the first to publicly announce the Evolution Market scam via a post on Reddit. D.Web inquired about an interview in an attempt to shed more light on the situation. Unfortunately, we cannot say that we have learned a great deal of new information regarding a resolution to the scam, but it's not to say that D.Web did not learn valuable information about the events that led up to the collapse of the largest darknet market. One must bear in mind that the scams of this nature typically don't hold much hope for ever revealing the true motive behind it. Proof of ID can be found here, a PGP signed message with the initial version of this interview. Editor's note, more information was added later. His PGP key can be verified by checking his Argo profile. Who are you? Vendor, etc. I'm Bliss, my original personal alias on the darknet. I became a vendor and named myself NSW Great, a copy of another vendor, S.A. Great, who was a good friend of mine. I trafficked to get heroin, meth, cocaine, GHB, LSD, DMT, oxycodone, DOM, and basically everything else you could probably think of when you think of drugs. What was your role on the Evolution Marketplace? My official job title was a public relations for the Evolution Market. How long have you been working with them? I have been working alongside Kimball and Vitro for about 4 or 5 months. Can you describe your day-to-day job there? Day-to-day job was general administration of the forum, processing scam reports, and investigating into vendors who were reported of stealing funds, selling drugs incorrectly labeled, and general support for buyers who were distressed about transactions with vendors. How was your communication with admins? I spoke with admins on a daily basis and became quite close friends with them. I have said it in the past and I still think it now, despite what they've done, that they are nice people, too smart for their own good, and that is for sure, it was so real. When did you start feeling that something went wrong? Evolution runs like clockwork, so as soon as withdrawals started slowing down and delaying, I knew something was wrong. We started pushing vendors more harshly than usual, disabling their ability to withdraw their funds. I noticed that automatic withdrawals were disabled, which is odd, and manual withdrawals were being done, which explains why it was taking so long. What do you do when you realize this? It took me a while to realize except what was happening, but I went straight to DNN Reddit, as I knew this was the only place that would be able to they wouldn't be able to censor. Can you share any information you had as an insider on what made the admins cam at this time? Maybe they got hacked or something. It was time to get out. It's terrifying running these markets. Can you estimate how much was lost? I laughed when they said 12 million to 33 to 33, 8 million total was stored across Evolution. Good luck finding it. 33 million is more than most estimates. How do you get to this number? I was able to see transaction history. The last I saw it was 35 million. Withdrawals were being done, and they may have been more. I rarely checked transaction histories in total. The marketplace had 35 million in Bitcoin and escrow, while it's something around 130k BTC total. How many sales you were having on Evo? I'd rather not say. How much did you lose? I'd rather not say. Will you keep bidding? If so, where? Not much for much longer. I'm having a huge closing down sale for ASU, which is Australian customers, 50% and more, over on Argo. It is no longer safe for me to be a vendor, and so I'm clearing my stock. I have a kilo of cocaine to move and over 100 sheets of 900 blotters of needlepoint LSD to sell. This is my profile on Argo. Did you respect any LE involvement in Evolution? No, never. The entire team were criminals with roots back to SR and BMR in some shape or another. Do you think anyone else was cooperative with admins like mods or vendors? None. They did it on their own accord. So SR is Silk Road and BMR is a black market. Anything else you want to add? Warn people some advice to minimize their losses in? Fund decentralized market projects such as Cloakcoin and their market. They're the only way for this to work. So that occurred all the way back in March of 2015. So this has almost been 2 years. And this is about the actual post. Evolution Marketplace exit scam, biggest exit scam ever. Estimated loss 40,000 BTC, around 12 million. Well, after posting yesterday about the withdrawal issues, it's pretty much confirmed now that the admins at Evolution Marketplace, the markets that have been regarded as the biggest market, currently have been the exit scamming it, and unless proven otherwise, they're now gone with everyone's funds in what appears to be the biggest exit scam in the dark net history. says the sheep marketplace scam. Those guys actually just recently got sentenced, and we'll talk about them in a moment. This is now confirmed as this time how much money was lost in the process. Some unverified claims say around $12 million, but it's pretty much the same to assume it's many millions of dollars in BTC. The market is now down, and Evolution staff member NSGW Gray posted this on Reddit. I hate to be the bearer of bad news, but I've been suspicious the past few days with the growls not working, and admins usually are more forthcoming and explain to me why they're slow, but they weren't this time. Just keep giving me time frames. I have admin access to see parts of the back end. The admins are preparing to exit with all the funds. Not a single withdrawal has gone through in almost a week. Automatic withdrawals have been disabled, which is only done on rare occasions. I'm so sorry, but Vitro and Kimmel have fucked us all, and I have over 20,000 in escrow myself from sales. I can't fucking believe it. Absolute scum. I'm giving this warning to you all as soon as possible as I could have. Confronted Kimmel and Vivo about it. They confirmed it, and they're doing it right now. Edit. Servers have gone down, including backup servers for staff. I'm sorry for everyone's losses. I'm gutted to displeased, and I feel so betrayed. So Sheep Market scam, which had over $40 million, the biggest darknet scam ever, was back in 2013. Sheep Marketplace disabled withdrawals but allowed deposits for the past 10 days or so. They have now disabled the forum after deleting posts related to the inability to withdraw or just starting to show dark moving the Bitcoins from the marketplace to another location. Sheep Market is now officially down. See details here. Update, apparently one vendor did use a bug in the marketplace and did steal 5,500 BTC from Sheep Pocket, so the admin ran away. Sheep Market owner, coder exposed. This is the second biggest scam in progress. And so these guys actually got caught, the Sheep Market owners, in just a review. It was an anonymous marketplace, much similar to Silk Road. It was one of the lesser known sites. With the closure of Silk Road, it started gaining a bit of transaction, if you will. In December 2013, Silk Marketplace announced that one of the site's vendors exposed a vulnerability to steal, here is Wicca, 5,400 bitcoins, which was valued about $6 million at the time. In 2015, the Czech police arrested a man suspected to be the Sheep Marketplace thief when he paid for an expensive house entirely in bitcoins. Finally, in May 2016, the theft was traced to two men from Florida via tracing bitcoin transactions via Coinbase. And those guys went on to trial. So the guy in Czechoslovakia is going to face up to 18 years in prison. And the Florida guys are still going through the process right now here in the States as far as what time they're going to be serving. They forfeited a lot of their money, everything. They were just trying to kind of stupid. They converted their bitcoins and were trying to move the funds through all various bank accounts, and that's how they got caught.
So basically, to sum it up, you want to have a place where you can have a strong, verified reputation, be able to conduct commerce peer-to-peer, from vendor to seller, without any kind of friction, without any kind of government interference, without any corporate interference. And you want to be able to do this in a manner that allows for nothing to be seen, nothing to be tracked, nothing to, like, a third party or a government agency to attack, because it's all decentralized. It's all these servers around the world that have this program running. And the consumer and the seller are also running the program, so there's no way for you to whack them all and track things down. You also want security. You want to also be able to conduct transactions in a money manner that's able to go across globally, which is what Bitcoin is. You can buy and purchase items through that marketplace, but also you can either transfer it to your local currency, or turn around and use it. They're trying to close the loop to purchase whatever goods if you're a seller for your own business, or as a consumer, you might be able to, you know, purchase through your bank account and transfer it into Bitcoin and be able to sell in a very easily, readily manner. And you also want to prevent these kind of types of scams where people on a massive scale are just ripping people off, whether it be like kind of an eBay situation where they're creating a rigged marketplace, or Google or Amazon pushing mom and pop places out, or as in the case of these exit scams, they're just running rampant in the dirt, the drug marketplace. You want to kind of stop that from happening, and that's why the creation of these decentralized marketplaces, which is not a new concept, it's something that people have been talking about. We'll get into the origins of the cypherpunk movement on a word for the metaverse. But it's something people have been talking about for years, that the marketplace as it is, the free and open marketplace, is not what it's what people think it is. And that by taking control back onto an individual basis, you're going to get that free marketplace. You're going to have that decentralized nature where it's not rigged markets. You're not having government interference or over-regulation or under-regulation. It's just peer-to-peer, easy-peasy, where people are able to, you know, buy good, sell good, and that's just pretty much it. That's the end of any type of interaction. If you want to find out more about the flow of evolution, I have a link to an article from Darknet Markets, which talks about Gruen, one of my favorite posters in the technology area, that was a moderator, an admin, if you will, on the Darknet Marketplace. He stepped away after the collapse of Evolution and Silk Road and stepped away from that. He has a really great site about Silk Road, as well as his analysis of, if you like, Death Note. So great read if you like the manga Death Note in the movies and in that series. There's a post by him speaking about his post. A detailed article from International Business Times about the fall of evolution, and then we'll cap off with what Andy Greenberg has to say about Silk Road's dark web dream is dead at the end of this episode. But what is a decentralized marketplace? Let's talk about those terms and get into what is out there and what's being created. So let's cover some of these terms. Peer-to-peer, it's coming from the Wicca, is a computing or network distributed application architect that partitions tasks or workloads between peers. Peers are equally privileged equipment participants in the application. They're said to form a peer-to-peer network of nodes. So this concept, you've already seen this at the world at large. You've seen this with Silk Road, which was peer-to-peer, but wasn't decentralized. You've seen it with Mapster, the very early on, and the prototype for a lot of this new wave movement of the internet, from we'll talk about Open Bazaar to even Silk Road to even Bitcoin to Facebook. It inspired a lot of these concepts and we'll eventually talk about Napster through both Hiroja's Thought Bubble, where I review the documentary by Alex Winter, who did not only the deep web, but he did a documentary on Napster called Download, but also on a Word for the Metaverse, where I cover Napster and how it inspired this new wave of thinking of the internet by taking the concepts and ideas of the cypherpunk movement and applying it to the internet, which is what cypherpunk movement is part of, but applying it to music and applying a lot of different concepts of like open source, social engineering, a lot of different things went on, social media, a lot of things went on within Napster, just beyond just the sharing of music, which was essentially important. Is the reason why like MP3 files are pretty much the standard format. It was because of Napster. There were a lot of other file formats out there, but because of Napster, MP3 files is pretty much the standard. But I've digressed a little bit there. So peers make a portion of their resources, such as processing power, disk storage, network bandwidth, directly available to other network participants, without the need for central coordination by servers or stable hosts. So basically, everyone's sharing the burden of using the program, using the product, participating at a kind of an equal level, if you will. Peers are both suppliers and consumers of the resource, in contrast to the traditional client-server model in which the consumption and supply of resources is divided. So everyone's on an equal footing when they're part of the peer-to-peer network. Emerging collaborative P2P systems are going beyond the era of peers doing similar things while sharing resources, are looking for diverse peers that can bring in unique resources and capabilities to a virtual community, thereby empowering to engage in greater tasks beyond those that can be accomplished by individual peers.
yet they're beneficial to all peers. So there might be considered super peers that are, maybe they, for example, when we talked about our review of Roja Thought Bubble about Open Bazaar, how Obi-Wan, the company, created the software program Open Bazaar. But as a company itself that only maintains the code, which is open source and anyone can fork it if they want to, they created servers that people can utilize that some people might not have the capacity or the ability or the resources to host their own server to get onto the Open Bazaar platform. So they have created a server hosting service so people can go through them if they choose to. Now they can either use their servant host or they can use their expertise on how to host so they can set up their own hosting thing, whether it be through a virtual machine, another third-party service, or within their own. That is a service that they're providing. So that is beneficial to the peer-to-peer network, if you will. And there's other competitors on OpenBazaar that do the similar tasks. So it's not just exclusive to the Obi-Wan company. Anyone can go up and say, hey, I can help you host your own, your store, if you will, through this type of servicing process. And you can say that they are, in essence, almost like a super peer because they're participating in the network. They're adding something, a stronger value to the network that all the peers can benefit from. But it's also not very exclusive to them, and it's not a client-server type of a deal because it enhances the peer network. Anyone has the capacity or the ability to do this can do so, and you can choose to participate with that person or not. It's not a necessary add-on that you have to go through Obi-Wan or you have to go through this particular hosting service. While PPT systems had previously been used in many application domains, the Architect was popularized by the file sharing system Napster, originally released in 1999. The concept has inspired new structures and philosophy in many areas of human interaction, in such social contexts as peer-to-peer as a meme, referencing to the agglutinating social network that has emerged throughout society, enabled by internet technology in general. So we're taking the concept of peer-to-peer, and we're making it decentralized. While Napster was peer-to-peer, and there was a bit of a shared burden where one person had, you know, all the Metallica and was sharing it to everyone else, all that content still went through the Napster servers, so it was centralized. It wasn't decentralized, so it wasn't, while it was peer-to-peer where interactions were going from one person to another and they were all sharing the network and sharing some type of burden, whether it be hosting or sharing or something like that, sharing files, if you will, or uploading files or downloading files, the server aspect of it was on Napster's end. It was in that centralized location. That's how they got hit. And it's one of the reasons why they got shut down. With a decentralized thing, not only you're uploading and downloading information with this new decentralized marketplace, but you're hosting it yourself. You don't have to use a third-party hoster if you don't want to, but you can host it yourself. It's built, the architect is built that you as an individual have that complete autonomy and control of your participation within the network. You're doing pretty much everything yourself. And because it's within your control, you control the inputs and outputs of the information. But again, when it comes to like some corporation, like for example, Obi-Wan can't shut down a particular company on one of the decentralized marketplaces we're going to talk about on this episode. And I highly recommend going and listening to Roja's Thought Bubble on a review of Open Bazaar. But for as an example, they can't shut down a host simply because that host might be, I don't know, selling firearms, which happens on like Facebook and Amazon sometimes and eBay. They're not going to get shut down. If Obi-Wan got a subpoena from the government, there's no way for them to obtain any of the type of the information about the store because they don't have access to it. It's that particular store, and it would be the responsibility of the government to somehow find that store and find that their server information, all that information, and contact the store directly to issue the subpoena. So it's very different from the structure that is that was a Silk Road marketplace, where Silk Road controlled the servers, and they also had the escrow service and the fee service. Because of the escrow service controlled by them, they controlled a lot of the funds going on the marketplace. Because of the servers, it allowed for the government to attack and take them down. But because of the escrow type of service, which a lot of people copied and modeled into their own new drug marketplace, That's where all these exit scams happen, where they basically, bad actors were able to take customers' funds, if you will. Now, another add-on that a lot of these decentralized marketplaces are doing is anonymous messaging, like the disappearing messages that you have, which used to be a very strong feature on Snapchat. I think it's WhatsApp, disappearing messages. Wicker, those encrypted end-to-end encrypted messages that disappear after a set amount of time. And end-to-end encryption is something that is being added on to a lot of dark marketplaces to prevent if one person were to be found out by law enforcement, I guess, or someone were to get hacked. You're not going to find out all the contents of people's communications if you don't have the private keys, if you will, to look at those messages. It's another layer of security. Again, when it comes to that on that end, it all has to do with the user actually enacting all those security measures, but it's a feature that a lot of these new decentralized marketplaces are embedding within their software system so that people have that feature available to them. So anonymous P2P. Anonymous P2P communication is a peer-to-peer distributed application which the nodes or participants are anonymous or pseudonymous. Anonymity with participants is usually achieved by special routing overlay networks that hide the physical location of each node from other participants. Interest in anonymous P2P systems has increased in recent years for many reasons, ranging from the desire to share files without revealing one's network identity, risking litigation, distrust of government's concerns over mass surveillance, data retention, lawsuits against bloggers. And basically what it is this type of feature not only for communication, but as another layer protocol in the peer-to-peer network, allows for whenever you have a node or a server and you're participating in a program, you're not going to get found out. Motivation for anonymity. There are many reasons to use anonymous P2P technology. Most of them are generic in all forms of online anonymity. P2P users who desire anonymity usually do so if they do not wish to identify as a publisher, sender, or reader receiving of information. And common reasons include censorship at the local, organizational, or national level, personal privacy preferences such as preventing tracking or data mining activities. The material or is distributed is considered illegal or incriminating by possible eavesdroppers. Material illegal but socially deplorable, embarrassing, and problematic in the individual social world. Fear of retribution against whistleblowers, unofficial leaks, and activists who do not believe in restriction of information or knowledge. A particular overview on legal and illegal content is given in the philosophy behind Freenet, which we'll eventually cover on a word from the metaverse. Governments are also interested in anonymous PPC technology. The United States Navy funded the original underground research that led to the development of the Tor network, which was later funded by the Electronic Frontier Foundation and is now developed by the nonprofit organization the Tor Project Incorporated. Tor is also a feature that a lot of these decentralized marketplaces have incorporated, so that when you connect to the decentralized marketplace, you're anonymous. So by having that feature, it's another barrier, or I should say, another layer of protection for both the consumer and the vendor in preventing any type of, again, from what was already been listed here, any type of outside forces or malicious actors, or just simply from your information just getting out there in the world. Just look at all the various data dumps and leaks that have been happening. You know, even with the WikiLeaks stuff has been happening, but there's been ever a lot of consumer hacks that have happened where all these different emails, particularly the Yahoo breach, which is increasingly becoming bigger and bigger as more breaches are being found that have happened, that information is not going to be found out, if you will, by having this type of layer. And Tor, since the collapse of Silk Road as a marketplace, and we'll talk about Tor, and the fact that the FBI and government agencies have been able to de-anonymize people, they have since reconfigured Tor itself to prevent a lot of that, of what is happening. We'll eventually talk about Tor as an add-on here. We're talking about the changes as a result of the collapse of the Silk Road marketplace. So decentralized computing, another component that gives it the decentralized marketplace its name. So decentralized computing is the allocation of resources, both hardware and software, to each individual workstation or location. In contrast, centralized computing existing where the majority of functions are carried out or retained from remote centralized locations. So centralized servers like AWS, Amazon Web Service, that host, you know, pretty much the majority of the internet. You know, Netflix would not exist if it wasn't for Amazon's web service. And even Netflix itself has looked into peer-to-peer function software as a better means to be a global distributor of entertainment content. But that's a discussion for another time. Decentralized computing is a trend in modern-day business environment. This is opposite of centralized computing, which is prevalent during the early days of computers. A decentralized computer system has many benefits over conventional centralized networks. Desktop computers have advanced so rapidly that their potential performance far exceeds the requirements of most business applications. The result is most desktop computers remain idle in relation to their full potential. A decentralized system can use the potential of the system to maximize efficiency. However, it's debatable whether these networks increase overall efficiency. I don't think it's really debatable. I just think that the usage application, there's not enough test cases to demonstrate is use cases. I think, you know, Bitcoin being one of the largest supercomputers in the world has pretty much demonstrated that decentralized computing systems are very effective and very efficient and can be very pervasive and distributed pretty consistently globally. Granted, it is still within the first world and much of the emerging second world or emerging marketplaces. You know, the Western world is heavily utilized, China, India, the emerging markets of the South, Eastern regions. You know, many of those places have been built up. There's still certain regions in the Southeast Asia, if you will, that are still emerging. South America, you know, you have Venezuela, Brazil, utilizing Bitcoin quite well, but it's not as dense as, say, in Western countries. It's not as populated throughout South America as you would say, the concentration in Europe, China, India, if you will, which is pretty heavily distributed. Russia, you see it pretty consistently in the major cities, but it's still not distributed throughout. Eastern Europe, it's still out there, but it's mostly heavily around the heavily populated areas. Kenya, Nigeria, South Africa, Egypt. If you look at the Bitcoin map where the nodes are and where some of the transactions are, you see it heavily concentrated in those areas and a little specks throughout the continent of Africa. Ghana is kind of merging there, but is not quite as dense or distributed as it is in the States, in North America, Europe, and China, and India. It can greatly improve, if you will, and even Russia is still pretty distributed there. And there's more work that needs to be done in the adoption in those areas to make it possible for that to happen. But what it is because computers, desktop computers, have become so powerful now, they're able to do network capabilities that when servers were first developed, a desktop computer wouldn't be able to be a server. Now you can take an old computer, I would say, even as young as, or not young, but as old as 2004, and you can make it a decent server, if you will. I recommend something like 2006 or higher, maybe 8 would be the lowest I would go to make it into a server or to a node or to any type of function like that. You can utilize all the extra space or power within a computer that most people don't utilize. They're basically using it for work functions. Maybe if they're gaming, maybe it's a gaming computer and you can use that for tons of stuff. But mostly people are surfing the internet and doing some photo sharing or photo storage. But for the most part, the power of the desktop is highly unutilized. And that's why you're seeing companies, we'll talk about in a second, that are trying to disrupt the cloud storage space. Like storage is one of those companies that I talked about in the past about our Musings of the Shy. Storage is a decentralized cloud storage place, so it takes the excess space in your computer and it distributes it to the peer-to-peer network where you're storing other people's information. You don't have access to the other people's information. The only people that have access to the information is the people who uploaded it. But it's your computer is functioning as a cloud storage unit, if you will. And how much space you allocate or whatever is based basically on what you're comfortable in allocating
and how much space you have in that computer, if you will.
So again, going with the Wicca, all computers have to be updated individually with new software. Unlike a centralized computer system, decentralized systems still enable file sharing, and all computers can share peripherals such as printers and scanners as well as modems, all on the computers in the network to connect to the internet. A collection of decentralized computer systems are components of a larger computer network held together by local stations of equal importance and capacities. These systems are capable of running independently of each other. So, based on a grid model, a peer-to-peer system or a P2P system, and a collection of applications run on several local computers which connect remotely to each other to complete a function or a task. There's no main operating system to which satellite systems are subrouted. This approach is a software development and distributed for the developers great savings, as they don't have to create a central control point. An example is a LAN messaging, which allows users to communicate without a central server. I also would say that, again, Bitcoin is probably the best example of a decentralized computing system, and is a technique that is being applied to the blockchain technology. The peer-to-peer type of concept and decentralization is being applied to a lot of these decentralized marketplaces. And this last bit from the Wicca, one of the most interesting debates over decentralized computing involved Napster, a music file sharing application which granted users access to an enormous database of files. Record companies brought legal action against Napster, blaming the system for lost record sales. Napster's violation of copyright laws by distributing unlicensed software was shut down. After the fall of Napster, there's demand for a file sharing system that would be less vulnerable to litigation, and that's where GNU/Gnome, a decentralized system, would develop. The system allowed files to be queried and shared between users without a central directory, and therefore shielded the network from legal issues of individual users. What also rose out of this was also BitTorrent. So if you ever used Napster, if you were old enough to use Napster, you're familiar with that type of peer-to-peer network, you might have gone to LimeWire, or you might have gone to GNU/Gnome for your music, and you most likely have utilized BitTorrent at some point, whether to share music, share movies, televisions, or just files in general. The client of BitTorrent, that type of system, is a peer-to-peer, decentralized type of system for the purpose of sharing media information. Touch on GNU/Gnome real quick, because again, this is about forking systems a little bit when it comes to decentralized marketplaces, where anyone will be eventually be able to create their own marketplace. But GNU/Gnome is responsible as a program. Again, this is coming from Wicca. It was a peer-to-peer network. It was first decentralized peer-to-peer network of its kind, leading to other leader networks adopting the model. It celebrated a decade of existence on March 14, 2010, as a user base in the millions for peer-to-peer file sharing. The first client from which the network got its name was developed by Justin Franklin and Tom Pepper of GNOLSOFT in early 2000, soon after the company's acquisition by AOL. On March 14, the program was made available for download on GNOLSOFT servers. The event was prematurely announced on Splashdot, and thousands downloaded the program that day. The source code was to be released later on the GNU General Public License. However, the original developers never got the chance to accomplish this purpose because AOL pretty much stopped it. But because the program was out, it was reverse engineered and then redistributed as a free and open source program that appears to be today. The parallel development of different clients by different groups remains the modus operandi of GNU/Gnome development today. Among the first independent GNU/Gnome pioneers were Gene Kahn and Spencer Kimball. They launched the first portal aimed to assemble the open source community to work on GNU/Gnome, and also developed GNULi, one of the first open source GNU GPL programs to implement the GNU/Gnome protocol. So it became very popular. Again, it's a decentralized protocol program, peer-to-peer, and is one of the early pioneers of the whole concept of not only peer-to-peer, but decentralized systems. The design to envision how GNU/Gnome originally worked, imagine a large circle of users called nodes, each of whom have GNU/Gnome client software. One initial startup, client software must bootstrap and find at least one other node. Various methods have been used for this, including a pre-existing address list of possible working nodes shipped with the software, using updated web caches of known nodes called GNU/Gnome web caches. UDP, host caches, and rarely even IRC. Once connected, the client requests a list of working addresses. The client tries to connect to the nodes it was shipped with, as well as nodes it receives from other clients, until it reaches a certain quota. It connects to only the many nodes, locally catching the addresses it has not yet tried, and discards the addresses that are invalid. So if someone's not on, or decides to disconnect, they're not a valid node, if you will. And it's just kind of a circle, if you will, of various file transfers and queries, and everyone's running this program, and they're connecting and working together. Not to go into too heavy detail here, but just kind of give you a list of GNOME Duo clients you may have utilized at some point if you've been on the internet for any period of time. You know, there was Acquisition, BearFlix, BearShare, Cabis, CritisWires, FilesWire, Gift, KC, Kiwi Alpha, LimeWire, Morpheus, Fix, Poison, Sharezar, Wireshare, and Zoltrax are some of the popular ones that people utilize, especially in LimeWire. Hated LimeWire. I like connected everyone. If someone had LimeWire and you were connected to the modem, your computer somehow got sucked into LimeWire, and it really, really sucked. So basically, LimeWire was the equivalent, showing my age here, of when you are on the dial-up modem and you're connected to the internet, and then somebody picks up the phone because they want to make a phone call and disconnects you. That's pretty much what LimeWire was for the longest time, if someone had that and was, you know, downloading it and sharing music. Everyone's computer was on the modem at the same time. So in the show notes, I have a list of peer-to-peer project lists, a collection of peer-to-peer decentral projects. This was collected by Moshest on GitHub. I also have the Mira link and the GNU net. But just kind of give you an idea of where these peer-to-peer decentralized projects are at. They're on the web, their communication, their platforms and frameworks, finance, data transfer and streaming, storage, and some of them are in progress. So one of these projects we're going to talk about as far as a marketplace or potential marketplace is ZeroNet. It's a decentralized website using Bitcoin as crypto and the BitTorrent network. ITP is a similar to Freenet and GNU, and Tor is another option that people are thinking of considering as a connection, as a way to connect to a decentralized marketplace. Communications, you have Bleep, RetroShare, BitMessage Talks, classified ads, serverless program for internet communication, including public and private messages. Ethereum is a platform, it's a framework, Blockstack, Backdome, WebRTC, Telehash. Finance, okay, you have Bitcoin, an innovative payment network and new kind of money, so as a means of allowing for people to pay for stuff through these decentralized marketplaces. Lazoo is a decentralized Uber app. OpenBazaar is one of these peer-to-peer marketplaces we're going to talk about for goods and services using Bitcoin. WeFund is an interesting project that we might talk about somewhere down the line. Along the line is a decentralized crowdfunding built on Ethereum. Storage. IPFS is a peer-to-peer file system protocol that OpenBazaar is incorporating. Storage is a decentralized cloud storage that we talked about. So there's a lot of these that are doing this as a means of decentralizing everything, but we're just focusing on the decentralized marketplaces, and one of these contenders is ZeroNet. Classified as might be, you might consider that as one of the potential ways of doing commerce. OpenBazaar. And then Cinero, which is a fully decentralized social platform, because just like Facebook, it will have people selling goods to each other through it. So here are some of the dark decentralized marketplaces that have risen out of the collapse of the Silk Road marketplace because of the existence of Bitcoin, because of for the already existing concepts of peer-to-peer. We talked a little bit about Gnonto and Napster that inspired these places. Because of these
fake marketplaces as well as these rigged marketplaces. People are seeking better ways to do commerce where they have more control and say, whether they're the consumer or the vendor. And one of these places I already did a review of, and I'm going to go too in-depth with, is Open Bazaar. It is a open-source, peer-to-peer, decentralized marketplace that you download onto your computer, whether you have a Windows, Mac, or Linux. You can either be just a consumer or you can be a vendor, and you create a profile, you run the program on your desktop, and you connect either by creating your own server to host or connect to the already existing server infrastructure, and which was done by Obi-Wan, and you are able to buy and purchase goods through the use of Bitcoin. Anyone can create a store, anyone can be a customer, and you buy and sell whatever it is you like. OpenBazaar just recently, with their latest upgrade in their software, has enabled and allowed for connection through via Tor. They're eventually going to have a 2.0 version where there's going to be video, the UI is going to look more clean, things are going to be a little bit more user-friendly. Server access is going to be a little bit more easy to manage for people for hosting. Basically, when you are a customer, you can connect on and off when you want. You just log onto the program, connect, buy your item or whatever. If you are someone who's a vendor, you kind of need to host your site, if you will. You have to be on. It's not like a web page where it's static and it's constantly up there because it's not being hosted by Obi-Wan or any kind of type of server. You have to provide the server. So when your desktop is on and you have the Open Bazaar program running, then your store is open. When you shut down your computer, then your store is closed. And that's where the servers come in, where you either do virtual machines, use a service like Obi-Wan where they can host your store for you, or you create your own server and host your store that way. All this is peer-to-peer. Obi-Wan doesn't take any fees. They don't control who's on the store. You can basically create whatever you want. I haven't seen too much dark marketplace type of activity, but that is potential to happen with OpenBazaar, and there's a potential for someone to fork the code for OpenBazaar and create their own type of marketplace. It's open source, so anyone can do that if they don't like the parameters of OpenBazaar. I see a lot of electronics, books, goods and services, web activities, all sorts of different types of businesses on there. Now, if you wanted to be able to search, the search parameters is not that clean at this point. It's still very early on in stages. The program has been live for about a year. It's been in development for a while. It's actually a fork of an idea of a dark marketplace that was by the creators of the Dark Wallet. Brian Hoffman forked that concept when that the dark market and the dark wallet didn't really coalesce to anything. He forked it and created, you know, Open Bazaar with his partner Sam Patterson. What else can I say about it? Because it's peer-to-peer, it's decentralized, so you're going to be utilizing the concept of Bitcoin as currency that's built into the program, but they do allow for the integration of Shapeshift when they go to the 2.0 version of the Shapeshift button, which allows for you to make payment through any type of cryptocurrency using that type of button, that platform, if you will. But it's baked in that Bitcoin is the currency of choice. Again, Tor, which is another layer of anonymous communication or connection, if you will. They have an encrypted communication protocol that they're putting in to OpenBazaar so you can make sure your messages are protected, if you will. IFPS is a protocol that allows for the different types of hosting and distributed information so that way, even when you're hosting the servers, if you will, the connecting and all the platforms like the software, the connection, the peer-to-peer connections, the load is a lot much cleaner and easier, but it's distributed in such a way to where, again, the data is not being tracked or monitored in any fashion. There are some clear services called DuoSearch and I'm escaping the other one, which they use their own specially built OpenBazaar crawler to get all the different types of stores on there and
posted on a regular website, so you can go and look at different stores and see what products are out there and find something for yourself before connecting to Open Bazaar, so you're not, you know, handpicking and searching and looking for something and you can't find it. They made that easier for you. When the new version does come up, the search parameters are going to be much cleaner and easier, and so you'll be able to find stuff more clearly, or the search patterns will be more refined, something you're more used to, like a Google or Amazon search when you're utilizing those type of web stores. And this is, a direct response to the collapse of the Silk Road marketplace and the censorship that happens on, and the controlled marketplaces that are happening with eBay and Amazon, as well as, the exit scams that happen with Evolution and the dark marketplaces where people are ripping people off and absconding with their funds, There is an escrow services that are hosted on Open Bazaar, but it's not controlled by Obi-Wan. We're actually working with a third-party service. So you can have an escrow service with a third party, but they don't necessarily control everything, if you will, depending on which type of service you utilize and your different fee charges. So it's an option there for you if you want to use an escrow service or not. Reputation is something to be built in where you can review the store, so that way you can have a reputation build up for as a vendor, which is very good for you. It allows for, for transparency, but also allows for people to, kind of gauge your product and quality and things of that nature. So that is an answer, a response, to you will, to the collapse of the Silk Road marketplace, to kind of fill that void, not just the dark aspect, but just in marketplaces in general. A decentralized marketplace is not controlled by anyone, is censorship resistant, that no company actually completely controls, no one individual completely controls. There's no rigged marketplaces or promotional things like that rigged to where the status of one person goes way higher than another. It's open source, free to distribute, free to utilize. Basically, all the burden of it comes onto the customer and the vendor, where you're hosting it on your computer. As a vendor, you're taking the risk with selling goods, and even as a customer, you're taking the risk, if you will, even if you utilize an escrow service to obtain your goods and stuff like that. So there's that response. Open Bazaar is, focusing on more of a Silk Road aspect, if you, but in more Amazon, eBay, more friendly, where they're focusing on just all e-commerce and not just the drug marketplace. It's one of the reasons why the Obi-Wan company developing Open Bazaar didn't add Tor in initial versions of it. It just recently did so, almost a year into the programming, because they didn't just want to start off being just solely a dark marketplace. They wanted other activities occurring on their platform, and their platform to be, tested and tried, for people to feel comfortable coming onto Open Bazaar and know that it's not just a drug marketplace, if you will. Now, Shadow Market actually seeks out to be that answer to Silk Road, but decentralized. It comes from the Shadow Project docs. They've been around for a while. They've been working on it for a bit. Let me read a little bit of history about Shadow. So about Shadow, we first start off with the history of Bitcoin. Due to the superiority over traditional methods of exchange, virtual currencies are quickly becoming very popular. Prior to Bitcoin, the largest problem for these virtual currencies was the prevention of double spending attacks. The shortest double spending attack is the malicious act of executing multiple transactions using the same units of currency, the equivalent of counterfeiting paper money. Bitcoin was able to solve this major issue by integrating the public ledger of all previous transactions known as the blockchain. Bitcoin relies on peer-to-peer network, where each member is a peer of the network and has the ability to analyze every transaction ever executed. This method of check and balances allows peers to see if coins have been previously spent before accepting any new transaction, thus limiting double spending attacks. So Shadow. Born on July 19, 2014, the Shadow project quickly distinguished itself as an innovative and unique open source project with a mission to create the first truly anonymous and decentralized cryptocurrency built with the Bitcoin's code. At the time, most cryptocurrencies had traced analogous to the traditional bank accounts with transactional protocols similar to credit cards, and the only way to privately transact peer-to-peer through centralized Bitcoin mixing services are by learning an entirely different cryptocurrency protocol, or crypto node.
Besides the privacy developments with crypto coins, the anonymity provided by traditional fiat system cash had yet to be fully realized with cryptocurrency space. The Shadow Project development team tasked themselves to create just that, a privacy platform built on the Bitcoin code base that provides anonymity without the need for a central middleman intermediary. Inspired by the cypherpunk anonymity movement, Shadow developers began simultaneously integrating emerging privacy technologies and services with security improvements based in zero-knowledge cryptography. By the time of the project's first birthday, Shadow had evolved from a simple idea of a truly anonymous currency into one of the most advanced cryptocurrency privacy projects to date. So they wanted to create a coin that was an anonymous coin, and we'll talk about Privacy Cash as one of the things that came out of the Silk Road marketplace collapse is because of utilizing places like Coinbase and BitPay, the primary Coinbase and Mt. Gox, where you had these third-party intermediaries that were they were exchanges that were allowed for the selling and buying of Bitcoin through them. But because of customer requirements at AML and the fact that the blockchain technology allows for knowing the complete transaction history, and you can actually now trace it back to a person's IP address, and if they utilize their real name or whatever, bank accounts and stuff like that, you can get the person's real identity because they're purchasing it through Coinbase. You're able to trace their transactions back to drug purchases and things of that nature. So because of that tracking mechanism that's within Bitcoin, that was a positive feature for peer-to-peer transactions to be able to prevent double spending, it doesn't allow for complete anonymity. And that's the one thing that people get wrong with Bitcoin. It's not completely anonymous. It's pseudo-anonymous. You don't have to have a bank card or a proper identity to participate in the network. But because of certain features within the Bitcoin, your identity can be tracked down. That's why people use mixers, or they use cash to buy their Bitcoin, or they do other different methods to try to be as anonymous as possible. But that's not really completely possible for everyone. And that's why there's a rise of the privacy cash aspect of coins that have come out because of that lack of feature in Bitcoin of being completely anonymous. And we'll talk about that when we talk about the rise of privacy cash. Because a lot of people's transactions, because of the Silk Road marketplace, can trace back to Coinbase or other exchanges and going through the blockchain protocols. When people get picked up by law enforcement, either for being a vendor or a user, they're able to use the blockchain to track them down and Coinbase and things of that nature. That's how the sheep marketplace guys got popped, was because of Coinbase. Because they utilize Coinbase as an exchange to convert their coins into cash. So the Shadow Project, as a response to that, tried to seek to create a cryptocurrency that would have that privacy feature. They also wanted that cryptocurrency to be utilized for their marketplace. And they've done other things. They have the currency they're doing. They're doing encrypted messaging. But what we want to talk about is the shadow market. So the decentralized marketplace. The main component of the shadow platform is a decentralized marketplace dubbed shadow market. The decentralized nature of the network makes it very resistant against shutdown attempts that permits anyone to participate in a true free market without the possibility of interference or eavesdropping by malicious parties. Every node in the network distributes and stores all the open market listings to prevent bloating the network with outdated and incorrect listings. Each one must contain an expiration date, and the appropriate listing fee must be paid. The blockchain-like mechanisms for storing listing is a technique called private information retrieval, and it's key to preserving anonymity and privacy of both the vendor and the possible buyers. So right off the bat, they're seeking to do something similar to the Silk Road, but with more privacy controls, if you will. So the second part of their plan is a two-part smart escrow. So see, they're going to have a bit of an escrow thing they're going to have some say in. The smart escrow system is devised so neither party can profitably defraud the other party without risk. It's based on the mutual assured destruction mat. The buyer risks twice the amount required for a purchase, and the vendor risks the purchase price plus the item that they ship. The funds are locked in a 2-of-2 multi-signature address and can only be released when both parties agree and sign the transaction. If they can't agree before a certain expiration date, the funds stay locked indefinitely and the address becomes unspendable. The expiration date is extendable if both parties agree to send the transaction to yet another 2 of 2 multi-signature address with a new expiration date. A new opcode, checklock time verify, is implemented to enable the multi-assured destruction. More about this technical specification of the improvement can be found on the BIP65 GitHub page. So this is something that when we talk about the BIP protocol for Bitcoin, when we discuss that, this is one of the features that people wanted to add into the Bitcoin protocol to do the upgrade. Mind you, we're still in the middle of the expansion that's in SegWit and Lightning Network and all that nonsense is still happening. Basically, the past almost 2 years, the stalemate is occurring. Shadow uses a different escrow model than proposed in Bit65. Instead, we drop both keys when the expiration is reached, essentially destroying the funds. So you're going to end up losing your money if you're a dick about it. If you don't send the goods, if you, as a purchaser, decide not to release it, you can lose your money. Mutually assured destruction. The strategy finds its roots in the ultimate game, a well-known economic experiment in the field of game theory. The key difference between Shadow's escrow and the ultimate game is that negotiations are possible in the form of refunds. The payoff matrix exemplifies all the scenarios without the possibility of refund. Bad buyer. If the buyer receives the item and decides not to finalize the transaction, then the address becomes unspendable after the expiration date and neither party gets their insurance deposit back. The buyer will have effectively paid twice the price, but the vendor loses his insurance deposit and the item. Bad vendor. The vendor does not ship the item, leaving the buyer with the option to finalize the transaction or not. Finalizing the transaction causes him to minimize his loss to 1x the price of the item, and the vendor makes a profit of 1x the item price. If the buyer decides not to finalize the transaction, he loses twice the amount of the item price, but also causes the vendor to lose his insurance deposit. The buyer is to some extent at the disadvantage and motivated to finalize the transaction to minimize his losses in case of a vendor scam. Both the buyer and the vendor will be motivated to extend the escrow transaction and work towards a refund agreement that both parties are willing to sign. Why not use escrow agents then? Because that brings the middleman into the equation, which is no means of fairly solving disputes. It's still the buyer's word against the vendor, and a delivery receipt does not always mean the correct item was received. What if the item is lost in the mail? The buyer will have to convince the vendor that he didn't receive the item, and both parties must come to a refund agreement that both parties are willing to sign. The vendor may believe the buyer if they have a good history of transaction. If the vendor thinks that you're trying to scam them, then he might decide not to deal with you again, and you lose your insurance deposit, and the vendor loses the item price and the item lost in the mail. Reputation. While the two-party escrow with a mutual assured destruction is a viable way to prevent most frauds and scams from being profitable, it's not a perfect solution of itself. This is where the reputation system steps in to complement the escrow system. Each vendor will have a reputation that reflects the dissatisfaction or slash satisfaction of his client base on the interactions with the vendor. Listing fees. The listing fees charged for each market listing is 0.2 STC per 4K bit per 2 days. So posting a 4K bid listing for 4 days will be 0.4 SECs, just as an 8K bid ad for 2 days will be 0.4 SECs. Updates to the marketplace listings will cost 0.05 SEC and will not add any duration to the listing. So they're utilizing their own coin, not Bitcoin, on the Shadow Marketplace. So this is something different. Hiding your IP, they're going to have Tor install. Support. For support, please visit our links through talkshadowproject.io. You can go on RSC Freenote or Slack. Join us at RPC API reference. Since Shadow has many new components, meaning we'll add an extra API calls on top of the original Bitcoin API. We break that down. So that's the Shadow marketplace. That project is encompassing a lot of things. It's the coin, a decentralized marketplace. Messaging services. It's a whole encompassing of the decentralized peer-to-peer nature, utilizing Tor as a mechanism to connect to the project and participate, and as a response, again, to the Silk Road Plate collapse is the launch of this project. BitMarkets is another response to that. So BitMarket is decentralized and anonymous. It utilizes the BitMessage network. It is used for post and buyer-seller communication, and the Bitcoin network is used for payments. The app connects to those networks using the location hidden or network. It has a two-party escrow, which is a bit different from the shadow market escrow service. But the seller puts up one times the price of the item as a deposit, and buyer puts up one times for the deposit plus one times for payment. They can only be released when both agree on the payment or refund. This keeps incentives aligned without the need for escrow agents or reputation systems. It's free and open and uncensored, so it's a free client, no fees, no altcoin. It's open source and available for anyone to download. How it's different from everybody else? BitMarkets, instead of using two-party escrows directly between buyer and seller, with no third party in our system, the buyer looks to two times the price of the item, and the seller locks one times the price of the item into transaction, and both have to agree how to unlock the payment or refund. It ensures both parties have an economic incentive to complete the transaction without the need of a trusted third party. OpenBazaar uses a trusted third-party escrow system, but these third parties have no way to fairly resolve a dispute, as they only have one person's word versus another. So there's the difference between the two projects. What is the monetization model? There is none. It's a marketplace with no middleman, including us, which is similar to OpenBazaar and the shadow marketplace. Who is behind it and how much? Well, the shadow marketplace actually takes a fee for listing, so there's a difference, which OpenBazaar and BitMarket don't do. Who's behind it and how much work has gone into this? Four people are working in their free time since the beginning of 2014. The history, it was inspired by Nash X. Steve Dierko, one of the developers, wrote a rough spec in 2013 for a market based on decentralized versions of it and ran on BitMessage and Tor and got feedback from the other developers. And then it went from being called, was called BitPost, and then eventually became BitMarkets. And so it's been ongoing since 2014. So Sitecoin is a Sitecoin is much like the Shadow Project. It's a coin built for the whole purpose of a decentralized marketplace type of system. So Sitecoin is a revolutionary cryptocurrency that offers zero cost financial transaction like Bitcoin and provides businesses that the infrastructure to trade goods, assets, digital certificates, and data security. Sitecoin isn't about money and trading. It's about the ability to track all business types thanks to its native set of features geared towards the financial sector, from eBay traders and high street shops to selling that one last item that you couldn't give away at your garage sale. Sitecoin's decentralized network benefits everyone. Unlike other cryptocurrencies, Sitecoin's intrinsic value derived from the decentralized services it provides directly on the blockchain. The blockchain powers all the Sitecoin services. It is a decentralized system of record, recorded, hosted by a series of nodes on the Sitecoin network. Sitecoin trades under the symbol of SYS and is a virtual currency exchange. So decentralized marketplaces. Sitecoin supports a wide variety of marketplaces ranging from the fully decentralized marketplace to a centralized business market. So it seeks to do both. Sell anything directly on the Sitecoin blockchain or build a site for your business that will use Sitecoin infrastructure to include its transaction. The marketplace platform provides a decentralized and high redundant channel for selling goods and services, and features include price pegging to currencies such as USD, Euro, CAD, CNY, and BTC. Bitcoin as a payment option, arbitrary escrows, encrypted messages, images, and unlimited inventory items. So it seeks to be everything and anything to everyone. I'm not sure if it's capable of doing both, really. It's just something that's been around for a little bit, and I don't think it's really has had the consistent market testing that Bitcoin has as a currency. Or even Ethereum as far as doing other activities. I haven't really heard much about Sitecoin. It's just something that people talk about as an option for creating a decentralized marketplace. But we'll see. Again, like this is just, again, a response to what is happening out there. This, again, because they're seeking to be more of a financial infrastructure, they will have an option for decentralized marketplaces, but that's not their sole function or purpose. And then you have ZeroNet. So just like anyone can create a web page, whether they use WordPress or they can use, you know, Facebook or something like that, because Facebook kind of has like pages and groups or something like that, to where you can sell goods and services through that platform. ZeroNet seeks to be an open, free, and uncensorable website using the Bitcoin cryptocurrency and the BitTorrent network. So it's peer-to-peer, your content is distributed directly to other visitors without any central servers.
It's uncensored, it's nowhere because it's everywhere, no hosting costs, sites are served by the visitors, always accessible, no single point of failure, simple, no configuration needed to download, .bit domains, decentralized domains using Namecoin cryptocurrency, no passwords, your account is protected by the same cryptography as your Bitcoin wallet, page response time is not limited by your connection speed, a dynamic content, real-time update, multi-user websites, works everywhere, anonymity, offline, the browsers that the sites you're seeding, even if your internet connection is down, open source, there's no fee to utilize, you can just completely download it for yourself, and so if you want to sell goods or something like that, you can create your own website through ZeroNet to do that. So it's another way to do a decentralized marketplace as well as being a website, so you have, you know, a little bit more say or control about your pricing, whether or not you want escrow or not, shipping and things like that nature is you're creating it yourself basically from the ground up. Much like a Webly or a WordPress or something like that nature, or Squarespace or any of the other type of web hosting sites out there that host e-commerce, you're doing this yourself through ZeroNet. And then I have a little brief section about Yours and Liber, where they deal more with digital content, you know, your blog posts, your MP3 files, your movies, whatever it is you want to sell digitally as something that you can utilize through Yours or Liber. Potentially you could, in essence, using their platform because they're more of a publishing platform, like a Medium, if you will, or an Amazon, like for book publishing or any of those type of sites, you could potentially sell, you know, hard goods or just goods in general. And it's not necessarily just digital content. You can have sell physical goods through the hosting of these type of sites. And it's, again, it's peer-to-peer and decentralized. Even though that's not their primary function, you can utilize it as a back-end to do that if you choose to do so.
So he had this response, this movement, if you will, there's some of these projects looked like they were kind of in people's ideas or minds, but came fully in development because of the collapse of the so-called marketplace. Take the notion of the peer-to-peer, the decentralized method, that, you know, the peer-to-peer that was popularized by Napster, that Bitcoin has demonstrated is possible, the decentralized nature that Bitcoin, again, as a financial system, has demonstrated being the largest supercomputer there is in the world. And Gnuple, an open source program that, you know, was a prototype or allowed for the existence of a decentralized protocol, you know, demonstrated in the real world, taking all these open source concepts, building it and shaping these decentralized marketplaces to cater to a market that needs it, to respond to a number of users out there that are seeking to not only sell goods or purchase goods either in an anonymous fashion, BitMarket or even Open Bazaar to some extent, or eventually Shadow Project, utilizing Bitcoin, but with Shadow Project, it's their coin, the SDC coin, and being able to have a frictionless environment, using ZeroNet, if you will, to create your own web platform. Yours are Liber, which are digital platform publishing sites that you could potentially not only sell your digital content, but potentially sell physical goods or just be an e-commerce site, if you will, building off that particular decentralized peer-to-peer platforms. And because of that, and because of the open source nature and you're able to download these protocols, utilizing virtual currencies as a payment method, it is a way to combat and go against some of the negative aspects of the Silk Road Marketplace. The escrow system, OpenBazaar uses a third-party escrow system if you want to. Shadow Project and BitMarket utilizes baked-in software protocol where you have to pay more when you're the buyer. You put up money in the seller into an escrow system, and this is a method to incentivize people to be honest with one another. Again, these are solutions to prevent people thinking that the creators of these sites are, you know, profiting or taking money or going away or stealing people's monies, not allowing for rigged markets, if you will, kind of tampering down on the bad actors, which exist, you know, not just in the dark marketplace, but also in the clear marketplaces, like with Amazon, with the fake reviews and the rigged marketplaces, and eBay for a while there was notorious where vendors and sellers were at odds with one another. All sorts of scams happening. And it still happens all the time, even through Craigslist or other different types of selling platforms. We try to tamper down and keep it minimized and making this as frictionless as possible. And all of this is as a result of the collapse of the idea of the Silk Road marketplace has allowed for the creation of all these other different types of marketplaces that may in fact bring about a more positive change to the internet, a way that's going to be more resistant and it's not going to have the overall government scrutiny that Silk Road did, because not only did it exist in the Tor platform, but because they were primarily, a drug marketplace. But these places are seeking to be beyond just a drug marketplace, but a fully integrated e-commerce place for everyone and anyone out there that has something to say, has something to sell, have something to do, and has doesn't want anyone to prevent that sort of freedom exchange, if you will. Mind you, as these decentralized marketplaces are getting into the market, they still have to compete against the centralized places like the eBays and Amazons, but also apps. A lot of commerce is occurring in apps, and I have a link in the show notes to like Glyph and Telegram and WhatsApp are all putting up marketplaces. Facebook, through their messaging app, is allowing connection of marketplaces. And because WhatsApp and Telegram and Glyph are end-to-end encrypted sites, it gives the sense of privacy as far as communication when it comes to selling and connecting with buyers. But because they're still in kind of a weird open platform, and because WhatsApp and Telegram could, in essence, prevent your goods from being sold, or you're kicking off of purchasing certain types of goods, you know, there's still some rigged markets and censored marketplaces can still occur within these app programs. But because they're easy to download, they already have a built-in user base, they have a clean and easy-to-use UI, and they're already utilizing the already existing infrastructure of PayPal, credit card, Visa, Venmo, and stuff like that. You know, decentralized marketplaces have to compete against that because of the perception of end-to-end encryption of privacy, which it does give for privacy as far as communication, but the perception of maybe privacy is marketplaces that are emerging within Glyph and Telegram. Well, Glyph is not so much like Telegram and WhatsApp, but Telegram and WhatsApp and Facebook on their end with the end-to-end encryption, a sense of privacy. Glyph is more decentralized end-to-end encryption. I don't see their marketplaces having any kind of censorship, if you will. That might be the one exemption of the as far as messaging apps that have turned it allowed for marketplaces to be created within it. But again, that's the complication with these type decentralized marketplaces have to do, particularly the fact that they're utilizing cryptocurrency as the primary payment form versus the existing financial infrastructure. So the last bit I'm going to read is from Annie Greenberg, and it's called "The Silk Road's Dark Web Dream is Dead." Not so long ago, the Silk Road was not only a bustling black market for drugs, but a living representation of every crypto-anarchist's dream. A trusted trading ground on the internet where neither the government laws nor the drug war they spawn can reach. Today, that illicit narco-utopia is long gone. Its once secret server is an evidence storage room, and its creator Ross Ulbricht fighting a last-ditch appeal to escape life in prison. More than 2 years since the FBI's Silk Road takedown, the dark web markets Ulbricht and Spider suffering a less tangible, more fundable kind of failure. The Silk Road's dream has died too. Over the last year, buyers and sellers in the dark web's underground economy have been shaken again and again when cryptographically hidden marketplaces they used to trade counterfeit goods ranging from drugs to stolen credit cards to forgeries have suddenly disappeared. More often than not, those disappearances involve the site's administrators running off with a significant chunk of the customer's money. The Silk Road purported ideology of enabling only victimless crimes has vanished. Fears of law enforcement surveillance, suspected vulnerabilities, and tools like Tor meant to protect the anonymity of the site administrators have eroded the incentive to create a long-term trusted business.
The result has been that the libertarian free trade zone that the Silk Road once stood for has devolved into a more fragmented, less ethical, far less trusted collection of scambling black market bazaars. Instead of a Silk Road's principle of so very illegal alternative to violence and unpredictable products of street dealers, the dark web's economy has become nearly as shady as the internet back alley politician and moralizing TV pundits have long compared it to. Dark web at market webmans are learning that if you're trustworthy, you stay up for a while, but heat increases and eventually you get nailed by the feds, says Nick Weaver, Beverly Computer Sciences researcher who has studied the Silk Road and other dark web markets. Instead, more and more markets are opting to exit stamps. Stealing the Bitcoin users are stored in escrow and in their own side accounts and going offline without warning. The most viable exit strategy, Weaver said, is to rip and run. The latest series of black market disruptions began with the banishing of the most popular Silk Road descendant, Evolution, in March of last year, which munches $12 million worth of his users' bitcoins. No sooner had competitor Argo adopted the site's refugee merchants than it announced it would return users' funds and go offline too, citing a need to revamp its security and likely been spooked by new details about the attack on Tor Human Services, as well as the FBI's massive takedown of dark web markets in late 2014. In the chaos of those two sites ongoing, going offline, buyers and sellers scrambled to lesser known markets like Abarex, Amazon Dark, Black Bank, and the Middle Earth. All of them sequentially disappeared too, likely have been pulled their own exit scams. Now it looks as if Alphabay, the last reigning top market with over 50,000 listings of drug and markets, drug and chemicals for sale and 12,000 fraud products, like stolen online accounts and credit cards, may be cashing in on users' misplaced trust as an endless stream of complaints on Reddit's Darknet Markets page and Alphabay's own Tor protected user former accused the site of intermittently stealing users' Bitcoin and deflecting blame to weak password or phishing scheme. Alphabay moderators didn't respond to Wired's request for a comment on the string of thefts. The numerous reports of Alphabay's funds going missing and the shady behavior from Alphabay administrators, Reddit's one popular online drug vendor known by the name of Grand Wizard Lair, explained his decision to longer sell the site, should have listed it when people said Alphabay is a scam site, wrote another user whose base coins disappeared, an expensive lesson learned. All that online turmoil has initially set the dark web buyers back to the street dealers, says Nicholas Christian, a computer science researcher for Carnegie Mellon, who published some of the most thorough measurements of the dark net markets. He says that the overall revenue of the anonymous online drug trade has hovered around $100 million a year, regardless of repeated scams and law enforcement takedowns. But the sales figures have plateaued after years of fast growth, he says. Perhaps in part because drug buyers aren't as happy or confident as they once were. We're starting to find the limits of these anonymous marketplaces. Economically, it's stable. It seems like whenever a marketplace goes down, another one picks up the pieces. Ideologically, it's very different now. There's no longer much of a sense of camaraderie. Christian argues that the dark web markets have been in a state of ethical decline since the moment Ross Ulbricht was arrested in late 2013. Ulbricht had, at least in theory, restricted the Silk Road sales to only victimless countermen, positioning the site as in need of a nonviolent anarcho-capitalist revolution. Never mind the six murders of higher enemies he's been accused of commissioning in secret. He treated his users as a community and wrote them love letters and ideological manifestos. All that made him a trusted administrator whose political ideas assured his followers that he wouldn't rip them off or quit Bitcoin. Whatever we're doing isn't about scoring drugs or sticking it to the man. It's about standing up for our rights as human beings and refusing to submit when we've done no wrong, Ulbricht wrote to using his pseudonym, the Dread Pirate Roberts, before his arrest in 2013. Silk Road is the vehicle for that message. Also, all else is secondary. But as so often happens with revolutions, reality caught up with Utopia after Ulbricht's arrest in late 2013 and the takedown of Silk Road 2, founded by several Ulbricht staff members a year later, the ideological bent of the dark web crumbled. Evolution, a new dark market created by former administrators of a credit card fraud site, took over with none of the Silk Road's prohibitions on fraud or stolen goods. Today, Alphabay offers its buyers a similar array of hacked credit cards and accounts. Given that these sites cater to actual thieves, it should not be expected they eventually resort to defrauding their customers too, Christian points out. They're not ideologically motivated, said Christian. They're in it to make money. When the temptation gets high, it shouldn't come as a surprise that what's on the table. For careful dark web customers, cryptographic tools do exist to avoid exactly the sort of Bitcoin stealing scams that have been plagued the Silk Road's descendants. A Bitcoin feature known as a multi-signature transaction allows buyers to put money in an escrow account. It requires a sign up from 2 out of 3 parties, the buyer, the seller, and the site itself to retrieve the funds. Unlike the traditional centralized escrow used by Silk Road, no single party of these three can spontaneously choose to run off with the money. A new fully decentralized marketplace known as Open Bazaar would go much further, allowing people to buy and sell products with Bitcoin through a peer-to-peer system with no central server that could be raided by the site's admins or seized by law enforcement. So basically, it's just that ideological decline is occurring within the dark web marketplace because of the result of the ideologues getting locked up and pushed out of the marketplace, either because they've been caught, they've gone underground, or maybe they realize, you know what, I need to get mine while I can. But dark net market observers remain skeptical of those solutions to the underground economy's trust issue. Open Bazaar remains in the beta prototype state for now, with only a few hundred users running test transactions on the network. A multi-signature transaction requires just enough effort and technical know-how. It involves copying multiple Bitcoin addresses into a certain Bitcoin wallet. Programs that generate the multi-signature escrow address that the vast majority of dark web consumers still haven't bothered to figure them out, says Berkeley Weaver. And if they do, he warns that there are many by so few multi-signature transactions in the large Bitcoin economy. Those next-gen drug dealers will be highly visible on the blockchain. Because Bitcoin's public ledger of all the cryptocurrency transactions is going to easily be figured out. Kind of skipping around. So all of this has contributed to kind of a stagnation in the dark web market innovation since a figure known as Corn, who served as one of the pseudonymous moderators of Reddit's dark net market forum until he stepped down from the position last summer. Grun noted in a goodbye post to the Reddit's dark web market community that the scene simply wasn't evolving fast enough to keep up with its constant cycles of broken trust, security failures, and petty theft. I was originally allured by the fascination of watching a small crypto-punk revolution, and I was hopeful that it would go beyond the original Silk Road model into a multi-sig and beyond, he wrote in a lengthy message using multi-sig as a shorthand for multi-signature transactions. Instead, the business model has proven remarkably durable despite the constant wearing turmoil of XX scams and hacks, and there it seems to be little chance that things will change substantially soon. The lack of evolution has made what was once a kind of a sci-fi only online drug buying wonderland into a collection of sketchy criminal sites that more than ever mirror the offline black markets they were meant to replace. The dark web markets are still there, just boring, Gruen sums up in an email. This repellent dream has been replaced by a dirtier reality. Respondent, R-E-S-P-L-E-N-D-E-T, dream. Has been replaced by a dirtier reality. So that's the status of the dark web, the dark marketplace. I do have some hope. I think when Open Bazaar and Shadow Market and these places begin to get get some headway here, I think there will be a break and you'll see more and more either similar decentralized marketplaces come into fruition, or more and more people gravitate to these type of sites to do their types of transactions, to get them peer-to-peer, to utilize Bitcoin, to have some trust gained back, if you will. But that's it for this part of the collapse of the Silk Road marketplace. Next up is the fungibility issue of Bitcoin, the rise of privacy cash, exchanges, and then we're going to close it out with the new edition of talking about Tor specifically because of its component being part of the Silk Road marketplace, but also the fact that a number of the decentralized marketplaces are using Tor. Some of these exchanges are beginning to use Tor. The changes in Tor itself has had to do because of the collapse of the Silk Road marketplace, the attack by various governments to take down dark web marketplaces, and what it's doing to try to be is the anonymous promise that it's seeking to be for people that need to utilize the internet and not have their information disseminated so widely or distributed either through government agencies or private entities, if you will. So thank you very much for listening to the moon, and next time.
Thank you for listening. Please rate and review either through iTunes or Stitchers or any of the podcasting apps that you're currently using to listen to this show. Thank you, and until next time.
This has been a Horosha Shine Space Odyssey Network production.